I was very kind of lucky with this. And I tried, you know, I experimented with a lot of stuff until I finally just kind of settled down. I was trying different tail pieces and different fasteners on the bottom. They have all these, they have this Kevlar stuff now, which apparently claims to make the tailpiece rock more.
So this was to optimize, though.
You
weren't just trying to make it look pretty. You were
I was really trying to optimize. I thought, okay, here I have this, I have a new thing. So I cut it, you know, I had a new bridge cut and a new soundpost cut. And I was trying to sort of, you know, I was studying about tailpiece lengths and the relationship between the bridge and the tailpiece and how you want perfect fifths.
Somebody was telling me that, yes.
D and B. A and A. And so it's a D octave above.
Yeah.
When you have that, the fiddle is ringing in the optimum way. When I move the bridge back a little bit, or I move
it
a little forward, it gets
it
sharper.
Oh, that's a good way to test it, huh? You've learned a lot about the instrument doing this, haven't you?
A lot. And in fact, a friend of mine just bought an instrument, and I'm like, hey, it's too high. Your tailpiece is not in the right place. I said, can I take it off and adjust it for you? And he's like, I said, trust me, I've done this, because I was really trying to
Optimize that.
So
it does make sense that the length of the tailpiece.
Yeah, because it's one.
Not just the placement of the bridge, but it's the
length of the tailpiece.
If you want your bridge in a certain place.
Right, because you want it usually. Kind of where the notches are, more or less, you want kind of a good... They say if it's like 1/6 of the string length between here and here, gets you a millimeter number that usually should be here.
Who said the players don't know anything about...
So this usually in the right place is... And I even carry this little thing here because I'm a little neurotic.
Yeah.
It usually should be about 54
hold on.
Millimeters. And you see that's where the fret is 54 and a half, 54.5. It's kind of spot on. And so I keep this in my case because I'm just, I want to make sure that everything is. And then you see these, for a while I was trying it with this Kevlar, which now the ends are frayed. You take this plastic off, you screw this in, you do a fisherman's knot to kind of adjust the...
He can sail too, or fish.
The whole thing, I can fish too. I had to look on YouTube how to tie a freaking fisherman's knot. Because they send you the instructions, they're like, tie a fisherman's knot to, because that enables you to adjust the loop length.
Oh, okay.
Then you adjust the loop length in accordance to this measurement, right?
Simple as that.
Simple as that. After 50 tries, you learn how to tie a fisherman's knot. And I still sort of can do it. But anyway, and it dramatically increases the overtones of the fiddle. But the problem was, it was so ringing.
Oh, too much.
Too much.
Huh.
So I lost all core. I didn't have any substance in the sound.
Just
a bunch of overtones. So it was like a ringing bell. So then I just went back. And then, I tried different chin rest brackets.
At some point, you have to just play, right? I mean, yeah.
Exactly. It's like I found my set of strings and I left it alone. Like Jimmy Lynn today said that, you know, Rene Morel used to give him a hard time because he was always futzing with the strings. And I've...
What do you use?
I just use the pies, the purples.
Okay.
And I found that they work the best on this. Dominance I didn't like. And then I use a Westminster E. I used gold brocut for years, but then I found that Westminster on this fiddle with the tension, because the E tension affects the G.
Yeah.
And so this is kind of a medium, I think, maybe a heavy gauged.
It does look like a pretty thick E.
It's a thick E, and it really gives more punch to the G without dealing with the sound post. I try to not
fool with that.
Mm-hmm. Do whatever you can up top without having to go on the inside. And you see he even has a black mark there. There's four dots.
Yeah.
Inside that kind of tell him
where the sound post
kind of bullseye is.
Mm-hmm.
because he's very, you know, he's a Japanese that studied in Germany. I mean, that's like, it doesn't get any more precise than that. It could be a watchmaker, you know. And so it's just kind of, and I leave it alone. Mm-hmm. I haven't touched the soundpost in 2 years.
Wow.
And that's the other thing about playing these new instruments is that I feel like with an old instrument, because of its temperament, you're tempted to. When I was playing I had a Guarneri, I was adjusting the post every 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Because I was like, wait, it's this. You know, you go crazy. But, yeah.
But you don't have to, yeah.
You don't have to, so you know, but this, I'm pretty happy
it's
with
beautiful.
This. Yeah, it does the job,
it's
you know.
It's beautiful and dim.
You know, but I'm curious to see what else is here. I mean,
what does it sound like? Just play a little something for. See what I was talking about today. It can take a lot.
For me, the D string.
Oh.
That it's support. Because the G string, you can. You can find a lot of fiddles that have drive on the G, but if a violin has drive on the D and it remains clean. Translates to me sometimes an overtone in the hall.
Yeah.
Like if you, the great Guarneris kind of have a little bit of that.
Yeah.
This is what I was talking about this with Joseph and Claudia yesterday about, she hates the grit.
Yeah.
She doesn't think that grit translates to stuff in the hall. I disagree.
Yeah, like when you're 20 feet away or farther, you're.
People used to say when they would stand next to Heifetz, it sounded like he was in a wood shop.
Well,
like,
the microphone. They
yeah, the microphone. Very,
too.
And it was not pretty.
Yeah.
You know, but in the hall, I said you go to row 5 in Carnegie, and it sounded like gold, like laser.
Mm-hmm.
Zuckerman is very much like that too. Zuckerman
probably
up close,
made it sound more pristine, more like
yeah,
clear,
it just gives
actually.
It more focus.
Yeah.
And Zuckerman too. You stand next to him sometimes, and it's got a lot of growl underneath.
Yeah.
You know. But then when you release. I had to work on that for a while.
But you can do it without, is what you're saying.
That you can, yeah. I couldn't get this to do that for about a year.
Yeah.
I felt like I had to press all the time.
Yeah.
And then to just, you know. Thank you. because I wanted that.
So, Giora, you're saying that the responsiveness increased over time?
Yeah, by playing it in.
Yeah.
But getting it to mold to your, you know, like when you feel the insole of your shoe, mm-hmm. after you and it has your foot outline.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's, I couldn't get. Like that.
Right.
I love that. Yeah. If a fiddle doesn't have that, then it's... Because everybody, you can play it loud, sure. Yeah. But that's not the music, right? So, but not every violin... But that's why I think adjustment is also very, very important, which we don't always talk about in these experiments, is that this... You can have the same violin... You can have five different violinists play the same fiddle and want five different adjustments, and you're going to get a different... Different overtone cycle, a little bit based on where the post is.
Yeah.
See, Zuckerman believes that every great violin, if you hear that a little bit ringing after the fact on the A and first position on the G, then it's adjusted right.
Huh.
Every violinist has their own neuroses.
But then, I mean, you can get that to happen on kind of a cheap fiddle, can't you?
Could.
I mean, really.
But that's that all it means is that it's adjusted right.
I see.
It doesn't affect the.
I see.
That's what he believes.
Yeah.
And that he says on Guarneri's it's more pronounced than on Strats. This kind of.
Sort of like the more you hear that, the better it's adjusted.
Yeah, and then the Guarneri's have this element in the bass range. Like, this is a Guarneri copy. So he used some dimensions of the Guarneri's. This is, I think, based on a 1734. That gets the wood to kind of... You get a little bit of that bell afterwards.
Yeah.
Right? So...
Wow.
But that also contributes to this business of the length here and the length here. The tailpiece is too long. And this distance is too short, the violin's not going to ring the same. All of that I learned switching to a modern fiddle. I didn't care about this stuff when I was playing something old, because you just think, oh, it's old, it's good, I'm leaving it alone. The only thing that I can control is the sound post. I go to a guy who knows how to move it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But the minute I got less scared with the wood, because I was like, this is not millions of dollars, it's not cheap, but...
It's not going to fall apart if
I
touch it or whatever.
Let me take off the strings. Let me take down the bridge and let me learn. I read on the internet and I was reading, you know, books and all these things. And you see what people are talking about. You know, the 1/6. And you talk to makers also. And every maker has their own theories. Like some makers don't believe in this.
Yeah.
The tuning of the fifths underneath. They say, you know, it's less important that it's a perfect D on the bottom.
Yeah.
And I said, you know what? It makes me feel good when I hear that, and I think the instrument responds differently. So,
yeah.
If it's a placebo effect,
who cares?
Who cares?
Right.
Right?
Yeah.